Hello. Welcome to my video sample for my presentation on the topic of how things go wrong. Hello. Welcome to my sample video for my presentation on the topic of how things go wrong. This is essentially a study of a lot of the pitfalls and minefields that we have to navigate as we move forward with projects and organizations. And particularly, we want to take a look at things from the foresight perspective. They always say hindsight is 20/20. At the end of a project, especially one that went wrong, didn't work out, it's always easy to say, how did this happen? And sometimes you can even, by looking at it, see what happened. And the bigger question becomes, how could they have let this happen? And what we want to do is go back to the beginning when they were making their decisions, because I think you really need to judge decisions based on what was known at the time. And this will help you as a manager moving forward to see the potential pitfalls and minefields as you get to towards the end of a project, the successful or unsuccessful conclusion. Now, this presentation is management focused in particular. It's got a business focus, but it would also apply to government agencies, any nonprofit, any organization you have that would be conducting projects. And it's also cross-disciplinary. It's not too deep in any one area like accounting or discounted cash flows, but it's not just entertainment or frivolous either. It's still very much informative. So this would be a good sort of all-around message depending on your organization or event's needs. So with that in mind, let's get started. As I said, it's a cross-disciplinary approach, so I brought some examples from different disciplines. The first one is going to be kind of a marketing analysis. The second one is going to be an issue that you face when decision-making. And the last one is going to be sort of an organizational behavior example. So with that in mind, let's talk about the first example I brought here. I call this, what do you do? One of the ways in which things go wrong is that you have a top line that is hiding a change of the components underneath it. And specifically, the examples I'm going to use are where a change in the components of the top line, the segments in the market, if you will, increase the volatility without that being realized by the management because they were focused on the top line. So let's take my first example from the U.S. auto industry. And if you look at, let's say, the U.S. auto industry from the 50s to roughly 2008, let's consider it roughly a straight line. I know it's not quite that simple, but for the purpose of illustration. I was working in the auto industry in the 1990s, and I read some studies that said, look, in the 1960s and 70s, the consumers were buying cars because their old car was worn out. Almost all of them were. Whereas by the 1990s, when I saw this research, about 40% of the car purchases weren't because they needed a new car, the old car wasn't worn out, but because they wanted the new features in the new models. And when I read this, I, as an analyst, was very concerned because I thought to myself, in theory, if we were to hit an economic rough patch, 40% of the North American vehicle volume could basically disappear overnight because those weren't people who needed a new vehicle. And if in uncertain economic times, they would be they would just opt not to upgrade to the new features. Whereas that wasn't the case in the 60s and 70s. And we as an industry were based on the recessions that had happened much earlier. And we didn't expect that level of volatility. Now, I was ultimately right about what happened. I'll admit I was wrong about the timing. I figured that would be the 2001 recession, and Free Credit managed to get us through that recession with relatively little disruption. But ultimately, I was right. In 2008, we had a financial crisis, which impacted the consumers much more than expected, and almost exactly as the study said, we'd lost about 40% of the volume within a period of months. And so this blue line sort of represents the people who are buying cars, and this blue component represents people who are buying cars because they needed them, they were worn out. And the red line is the new people who are just buying it because they want the features, they're upgrading. And as you can see, if you only looked at the top line, which I think was what the mistake the industry made, they saw an increase and they thought it was the same sort of blue segment all along, when in reality it was the growth of a much more volatile segment that caused the collapse. The next example I'll use is basically the same phenomenon but in a different industry, that is Las Vegas casinos. Historically, the blue segment here would represent the habitual gambler, and they're very dedicated to this as their pastime, some unfortunately addicted in fact, and they are very reliable as a consumer. of casinos. They will, even in tough times, they've always said Las Vegas is recession-proof, casinos are recession-proof, nobody goes broke buying owning a casino. And we recently found out that's not necessarily the case. And one of the main reasons for that is, again, we had the growth of a component, which in this case will be designated by red, and which I would refer to as the luxury component. Historically, Vegas was this blue component of habitual gamblers. But through the 1990s and early 2000s, we saw growth in the luxury consumer. People weren't coming to Vegas necessarily to gamble. There were many more people coming here for the luxurious hotel rooms, the spa treatments, the nightlife, the expensive bottle service, the fine dining, the fine shopping. And so we had a growth of this revenue, and you can think of this axis being whatever you like, number of customers, revenues, profits. Conceptually, they correlate. We saw an increase throughout the 90s and early 2000s, thinking, wow, this is great. The casino business is growing, not realizing that the underlying components were being dominated by a more volatile component. And of course, after the financial crisis, habitual gamblers kept coming, but people who were buying fancy hotel rooms and fancy meals and expensive shopping, they didn't need it as badly. They just went without. And all of a sudden, we experienced consecutive years of double-digit declines in Las Vegas revenue. So that's a marketing example of how things go wrong. So you gotta always mind your components as your industry grows. The next one I want to talk about is an example of decision making. The truth is, in business, we're oftentimes stressed for time and resources and bandwidth, and we can't always do it all. We can't look at every possible scenario, and so we have to make decisions about which ones to prioritize. And I'm going to give you a couple examples of where those priorities actually ended up coming back to haunt the decision makers. I'll call this choosing the details. You got to choose which details to focus on. The first one I'll use is the example of the Volkswagen purchase of Rolls-Royce. Some of you might not know this, but Rolls-Royce for decades had been struggling to make money because they're such a small volume manufacturer. They couldn't afford the investments to keep upgrading the technology. So they had actually put themselves for sale, and oftentimes many people expected them to be purchased by BMW because BMW had been supplying a lot of their technology in the past, their engines, powertrains, things like that. But Volkswagen said, well, hey, wait a second, if they're going to sell them, we're interested too. And Volkswagen ended up outbidding BMW for Rolls-Royce. But here's the nuance. What they purchased was the Rolls-Royce Motor Company, which included a factory and a generally outdated vehicle platform. But the license to use the name Rolls-Royce actually came from the parent company, which is the Rolls-Royce PLC. They make the jet engines. And what happened is Volkswagen bought the old factory and the old car, and BMW went straight to the parent company and said, okay, well, we'll just buy the name. And so Volkswagen ended up just grossly overpaying for an old factory and an old car platform, and now Rolls-Royce is made by BMW. And BMW started off with a greenfield. They just started off from scratch, designed and built their own Rolls-Royce and factory, and that's what the Rolls-Royces you get today are. Now, interestingly, the Volkswagen, when they bought the old factory and the old car platform, Rolls-Royce Motors did have access to the Bentley name. So now Bentley is made by, Volkswagen used Bentley as their substitute for Rolls-Royce, and now Bentley is made by Volkswagen. But the point is, going forward on the deal, they choosing which details to focus on, they didn't focus on the naming rights, erroneously assuming that if they bought the motor company, the getting the parent company to ascribe them the naming rights would be simply a procedural issue. And it turns out that wasn't. It became a contentious issue. So that's a missing which detail to focus on. Another example I want to use of this, and like I said, this doesn't have to be business. This can be any management, any team. A good example of this is the space shuttle. We have built 5 launchable space shuttles in the United States, 2 of which have been lost in catastrophic disasters. And the interesting thing is, in each of those situations, it was known what the problem was before the catastrophe. And oftentimes it was discussed by the engineering staffs. In the first one, there was an O-ring that did not respond well to freezing overnight to cold temperature. It didn't seal properly if it was cold the night before launch. It leaked gas and led to an explosion. And in the second one, again during launch, there was some foam insulation that fell and chipped some of the heating tiles, and they didn't bother to look at it, inspect it while they were in space. And as they came back towards re-entry, the broken tiles failed to shield the heat of re-entry from the vehicle, and the vehicle was lost. The vehicle again disintegrated. So both of those are examples of where even though the details were known, they didn't choose those details to focus on, and as a result, we had two different tragedies. Now, here's the really interesting point about those. I used the word choosing details very specifically. I didn't say necessarily missing details, because this is a good example of what I talked about earlier, foresight versus hindsight. In hindsight, you can go to the space shuttle crew, the space shuttle engineers, and say, that was a mistake, you lost the vehicle. But what they would respond with is by saying, look, at the time that we were considering that as a possible scenario for a catastrophe, we actually have quite, this is a very complicated system, a space launch, and we had a variety of issues that could have caused a potential catastrophe. And if we had taken the time to fix every one of them with absolute certainty before the launch, we'd probably never launch a space shuttle, because there's just a lot of complications, a lot of uncertainties. And so there's actually a debate about whether or not that is the right decision. I mean, clearly it was a catastrophe. We lost the lives of astronauts, but is that, it's awaited. If we fixed everything, we might not ever have a shuttle launch, and is it better to have, is that tragedy that worth the trade-off of having a shuttle program that can launch semi-frequently? So that's a little bit about decision-making. Let's talk now about, I called this the organizational behavior earlier. I'm gonna pick a specific example about corporate culture. You know, they say it's always easier to destroy than it is to build. It takes a long period of time to build a building, but you can level it in a matter of seconds. Warren Buffett likes to say it takes 30 years to build a reputation and 30 seconds to lose it. I actually think the same thing could be applied to a corporate or organizational culture. If you want to develop a cooperative, shared sacrifice culture, there are some easy ways in which that can go wrong quickly, and I want to bring up a few of them. One possibility is, you know, oftentimes if there are perverse incentives to play politics and to take credit for something, whether it's your idea or not, and avoid blame for it if it's your fault or not, a lot of people rationalize doing things in their self-interest at the expense of the organization under the theory of, well, this is going to get me to the top, and when I'm in charge, I'll fix it. And what we find is that generally doesn't work, because there's only one person, or maybe a handful of people if you wish to think of it as a team, leadership team, who can make it to the top. But if everybody throughout the organization says, I'm only doing this until I get to the top, you just end up with an organization full of corrupt people. I think this is, to some extent, one of the problems we have in not just business organizations, but also in politics. Everybody in Congress wants to be president, so they're always swapping deals to get to the next step, and because most of them will never be president, we just end up with a government full of sellouts. That's not specific to the United States, by the way. That's kind of inherent problem in any political organization, be it a government or a business. This can also lead to the next topic that I want to talk about, and that is that the if people see that, oh, and also, why wouldn't this be, you might ask yourself, well, why wouldn't the person at the top fix it? Couple reasons. One of them is, by the time you've got a fully corrupt organization, it can be difficult to move it, even from the top. And secondly, by the time you're at the top, you might have gotten into such the habit, you've adopted the view that this is just how things are done. And that can lead us to the problem of this last point here. And that is, if the top people oftentimes end up feeling entitled, saying, look, I've done a lot of work to make it to the top. Now I prefer to, I deserve some indulgences. I deserve golden parachutes and copious fringe benefits and retirement funds that are funded separately than my pension. My golden pension plan needs to be funded independently and protected from bankruptcy, whereas the workers don't necessarily. And that's an easy sort of sense of entitlement. And here's the interesting thing. When the people at the bottom of the level of the organization see that, they start to see the organization not as a cooperative shared sacrifice organization, but as a corrupt organization. They say, well, look, if they're going to do it, I'm going to do it too. So you end up with a situation where the top people are being poor stewards of the company because they feel entitled, and the bottom people aren't acting in the best interests of the organization because they feel bitter that they are still working hard and they're not getting to the top and they're not getting these entitlements. And so if everybody at the top and bottom is self-dealing, all of a sudden nobody's really looking after the best interest of the organization. So those are a couple of examples, and I want to be clear, I like to talk about what was known at the time, especially with this decision-making area, so that you can see how things can go wrong as you go over time. But it's also important to note, when you open up your your analysis to the possibility of what was known at the time, you are allowing people to start to spin what was known at the time, and maybe some sort of historical revisionism, like if something goes wrong and they're responsible for it, they might start making excuses based on my logic here. They might say, well, we didn't really expect that to work out. We knew it was a long shot when we started. So it's important that you've got to sort of find that balance between, you know, if you demand results all the time, nobody will take any risks and you'll miss opportunity. But if you allow everyone to just reinvent what was thought of to be known at the time, you have a political scenario in which you'll never be able to hold people accountable. So that's a balance that you'll have to draw. So anyway, these are some examples of how things can go wrong. There are more in my live presentation. I hope you found this interesting. If you would like to have it presented, please contact me for a proposal, and I look forward to doing business with you. Thank you.